The board kept turning me down. I didn't like that. There was two or three parades that basically after Congress, they said, you're going to make it without me. He gave a lot of.
He gave a lot out. More.
He was a smart guy.
No, I wouldn't call him a shirt.
He kind of did it his way. You know, your way is my way. My way is what we're going to do. But he was in you.
Say a few words, and I'm going to recognize some people who were at our first
otherwise season. I wouldn't be
I'm
here.
A word or two. Just a brief history of how this started. Back in the summer of the year 2000, I made a sales trip to Grand Rapids, Michigan. Heard about their military history club. Went there. Put about 40, 50 people in a small restaurant facility. And I said to Ken, hey, come on over. Let's take a look at this. Maybe you'd be interested in doing it here in Milwaukee. So he did. He came over. He was sold immediately. We came back, and our first meeting was December of the year 2000. And appropriately, it was a veteran of Pearl Harbor. So from that small, humble beginning, here we are. Probably the record crowd, certainly the biggest in about 16 years. So thank you very much. And let's hear it for Ken Griegas. The two people who succeeded me after I retired from this about the year 2005, Paul Radke, David Milburn, who has since left, and good friend Alan Buchholz, who did a lot of videotaping. Let's have a hand for them.
Thank you, Colin, for you and your wife both for all your work in those early years. Show of hands, this Battle of the Bulge was so massive. Few people realize how big. The Army lost 19,000 dead. That's 400 a day in about 7 weeks. And not to put down the Marine Corps, that's more than the Marine Corps lost in 3.5 years of battling in the South Pacific. So it's that big a battle. How many have had blood kin who fought in the Battle of the Bulge here? Look at that. Look at that. That's a lot of people. So on the behalf of your family, thanks for the sacrifices for them. If your name is called, you were at the first dinner the first couple of years, please stand up. We got Ron Korb. Ron Korb, stand up. You were there.
There he is.
One of the first guys. Mike and Kate Grunberger. Steve Evelyn. Where are you, Steve? Got Steve. And Steve's father was in 106th Division in the Battle of Bulge. We'll tell you about that in a little bit. Paul Schaub and his wife Sylvia can't be here. And one last one, Glenn Dorman, Korean War Army veteran. So,
I know Glenn.
thanks for staying with us. We have a PowerPoint map in a little bit, but right now, there is a really important event that impacted everybody to this day. On December 16th, somebody's plane took off from England, going to Paris to do a Army Air Corps band concert, and his plane disappeared. Nobody knows what happened to anymore. It sounds as good today as it did 75 years ago, and I just wonder how many songs could Glenn Miller have written and produced after the war. But he's a casualty. We don't know if German aircraft shot him down or he just had an accident over the English Channel. Well, the second song Paul will play in a little bit, if you were around the family radio in December of 1945, it was an anxious time. Families knew they had boys overseas. They knew about the Battle of the Bulge. And it's a tender, plaintive song. We hear it yet today. And this was a favor of GIs, often away from home, wondering if they'd ever be back home for Christmas again. And so let's play something from a wonderful movie called Meet Me in St. Louis. And this is Julie Garland. Let's hear her. GIs in their foxholes on December 16th will never have another Christmas. 19,000 died, and that's why we light this candle to honor their loss. Some made it to the Christmas of 1944, but they didn't make it into 1945. We're gonna have a PowerPoint here to come up, a little background, and Paul's gonna show a video. And this is a prelude, and I'm using this pointer because it's better than a laser light. Here's a map of Germany, and if we can expand it, there we go, great. The distance from the top of Germany down to the Swiss border is about 480 miles, to give you an idea. Well, we all know what happened on D-Day. That's over here in France. And the Americans, after they landed on the shore, they realized that they, instead of just going straight here to Paris and then on to Germany, they had a problem. They needed a port for more supplies to come in, and rather than just a crude landing area. So they captured Le Havre, which is off the map, and there's a peninsula up here west of Normandy, and that's called the Corentin Peninsula. And at the top of it is a town called Cherbourg, or Cherbourg. And we needed to capture that for a big port for supplies, but more importantly, there were German soldiers isolated in that area, and they said, we better take these guys out, because if we advance on Paris, they might come and attack us from the rear. So all throughout June, there was fighting there in this Carentan Peninsula, and they succeeded by June 27th, the fighting was done. So, all the way now, hey, one second, I got some background noise here, bear with me. Folks, we can hear you talking. Sorry. So, listen carefully. The Germans fought desperately, but General von Rundstedt, who was their field marshal, a week after the battle, he said, he radioed back to Berlin, and he said, "Ihr Idioten, you idiots, shut down this war immediately. We didn't stop him at the beach. Germany's finished." Well, the Nazis didn't like him, because he was an aristocrat, and he didn't like the Nazis, but they fired him. So, what happened? Germans steadily fell back, and they were badly beaten at two battles. One is Mortain, and the other one, the Felle Gap. Well, a lot of them, after Paris fell in August, middle August, they scooted back this way. So, Americans are down here advancing, British and Canadians north. Now, when I was a young guy, I was stationed right up here in Aachen, Germany, the young army soldier of the in the early 1970s. And that's the Germans' west wall. It's all fortified. Now, what happened is about the middle of September, we reached the borderline here, and we figured, hey, they're finished. We really beat their pants in Mortain and Felle Gap. It's just about over. And the Russians were advancing from the east, so it looked real good. The first German city to fall was the city of Aachen. And the British were pressing on the north to try to break through to their industrial Ruhr, and we then moved into a forest just a few miles south of Aachen. How many of you have heard of called the Hürtgen Forest, H-U-R-T-G-E-N? terrible fighting all throughout late September, August, November. Cloudy, so we didn't have the superiority of air power. The Germans, fighting on their own land, they really dug in. They also realized that they were going to be planning a big offensive, so they fought all the harder. I, stationed there for over a year, made multiple trips into this Ardennes forest area, and I'll tell you about that in a little bit. I've probably been there 15, 20 times, and once since getting out of the Army. I did a lot of exploration there. So listen carefully. This Hurricane Forest was a failure. They wanted to break through and head up here to Cologne, Dusseldorf, but the Germans really dug in. So here's what the Nazis said. In football, they call it a Hail Mary pass. Baseball, swinging over the fences. They realized they had to do something desperate. So they called General von Rundstedt back out of retirement because he was a good commander and he was well respected by the Army. And they said, General von Rundstedt, we have assembled a whole new army, and here's what we want you to do. We want you to attack through the Ardennes forest. Nobody will expect it. It's dense. Americans that were beat up in the Hurricane Forest, it's a rest area. They're bringing in new troops here from the States. They're green. And von Rundstedt said, skip it. And at shortest days of the year, you want me to go all the way to the coast to Antwerp, cut the British off from the Americans? That was their plan. Drive the British back into the sea, like at Dunkirk, and the Americans this way, they'll give up, they'll sue for peace, and then we'll go back and deal with the Russians. So Rundstedt says, where are you gonna get all these soldiers? Here's how we're gonna do it. Sailors who don't have ships anymore, Air Force ground crew, here's a rifle, you're in the Army now, you're in the infantry, you're going this way. 16-year-old boys, men in their 50s. They put an army together of 250,000 people. But most importantly, they took some of their best soldiers from the Eastern Front who were fighting the Russians. And these are guys who were probably the best soldiers in the world. They've been fighting since the beginning of the war. They were experienced. They were battle-hardened. They were used to winter conditions. And many of them were ruthless people. So, here we have it. The stage is set. Eisenhower, our general, Montgomery, the British general, made a bet. The war is going to be over by Christmas. They're finished. They're done. Well, the worst kind of surprises are the bad surprises. Nobody expected this. So on the morning of the 16th of December, the attack was launched. And we're going to show a video about that in a minute. But I just want to mention something. This area of the Ardennes Forest here, there's a little sliver of land here that is German-speaking, because northern part of Belgium is Dutch, they speak Flemish, southern is French. Now, after the First World War, as reparations and punishment to Germany, they had to give a little sliver of land to Belgium. And today, you'll see there's still 70,000 German-speaking there. And the Germans knew that, hey, we go back into here, there's a lot of towns with German names, these will be friendly people. So all the more reason to attack through the Ardennes. So I have a little something here, bear with me, and we'll get onto our video, and then we'll get our speaker up here. But first of all, I also want to mention, Norm Stadelska is here, and we'll have him introduce his family in a bit, but we've lost two of our speakers tonight. Last week, Joe Demler, I talked to his daughter, and she said, I don't think we want to let Joe out. You know, he would love to come here, but we're afraid in cold and flu season, cold weather, his condition's not good, so he may not see it. Joe's not here. The other speaker from Glendale, I got a call this afternoon, and they said he turned ill with a cold or flu Saturday. Doctor's orders, do not leave this house. Come back in January, January 20th. We have Battle of Bulge Part 2. Maybe we can get these men here. Those of you who want dinner, normally, we have time to sign you up on email. We don't have time to do that today. We'll do that in January. You call my number there for dinner reservation, but if you just want to see the program, just show up. And we always put this in the newspapers. Now, there are many monuments in the Ardennes area, but the greatest are the foxholes everywhere that remain today. And I was a young soldier. I used to go over exploring that area, and there are foxholes all over the place. And one of the best memorials just outside of St. Vith. It was surrounded and eventually conquered by the Germans. When the winter snows melted, the Belgians in the villages went out into the woods. They found a dead American officer. And around him, he didn't surrender. He went off in the woods fighting. They found several German soldiers that he took with him. And every spring, when the snows melt, there's a pathway from this little village. And the people go out there and put a vase of flowers by his grave. And it's a moss mound with a big cross that says, died here. One American officer, Lieutenant Eric Fisher Wood, U.S. Army, 106th Division, in the great Winter von Rundstedt offensive. I was there walking along a trail one time, and I looked at a fence post, and there's a piece of shell fragment in the fence post. I don't know if this thing spoke German or English, but it whined through the air, and this was the area the very first day of the battle. We don't know who fired it, from a tank, from a cannon. Don't know anything about it, but you can find helmets and all kinds of things there because of the vast number of people who fought there. And it's kind of spooky, to be honest with you, as you think of all the men who fought and died there. So, Norbert Jr., would you introduce your family? Then we're going to show a video. So, who all is here? You've got an extended family for you.
Thanks to Ken and the rest of the people who put this on. And before I introduce people, I just want to say, it's nice to see faces that I recognize out in the audience. Equally nice to see people that are obviously from out of the area and took the time tonight to travel and come here. Thank you. Now to introduce people. Okay, one sister right here, Victoria. Another sister, Veronica, and her husband, Gary, their son, Elliot. My wife, Gina. Oh, by the way, I'm Norbert Jr. There you are. My sister Elaine, her husband Jeff, and their son Chase. Sorry, Chase. Sorry, Chase. He's out of town. Don't see him a lot. But anyway, yeah, getting old. You know, you guys get it. Anyway, so that's the crew, and also my dad's friend companion Reggie Potter.
And who's over here? In this table. You have family here.
This is my daughter Chelsea.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, now, real quickly, if this is your first time, we want to welcome you. Come back in January, and we'll introduce you by name. But if this is your first dinner, raise your hand high. Great to see quite a few people. Thanks for putting up with us. Normally, it's not this crowded, but you come back in January. We'll do Capitol College Part 2. So, Paul is going to show us a video, tell us a little bit about it, and then we're going to take a seventh-inning stretch. So, let's move forward. Paul, what do you got for us?
So, we got a couple of quick videos. The first one is kind of an interesting graphical representation of the people who died. You're first going to see the size of a coffin, and then you're going to see how many coffins each country basically had to have, and it's going to be kind of graphically showing you from one to the other. There'll be some buildings to show you, get your perspective. And the second video will be a kind of a brief introduction of what the Battle of Bulge is all about and how it went. And then the last part will be a quick 2-minute video of a Hollywood portrayal of a movie about the Battle of Bulge, which I'm sure most of you will recognize.
The Battle of the Bulge, which was one of the bloodiest battles fought on the Western Front during the Second World War. A last-ditch attempt by Germany to avert defeat, it saw hundreds of tanks and hundreds of thousands of men committed to a surprise attack through the Ardennes forest. The attack was the brainchild of Hitler, who, against all advice of his generals, was determined to attempt an audacious knockout blow against the Allies. If the West could be forced to make peace, the German Führer reasoned, then the Soviets could also be pushed back and Germany saved from defeat. The operation, codenamed Autumn Mist, was to attack with the 5th and 6th Panzer Armies and the 7th Army, a stretch of the Allied front that was held by parts of Courtney Hodges' 1st Army. The Allies had focused divisions for their own attacks and had left the Ardennes lightly defended in order to do so. Spearheaded by elite SS Panzer divisions and 6th Panzer Army, the Germans aimed to smash through the American lines before crossing the Meuse and sweeping north to capture the port of Antwerp. If successful, the Anglo-Canadian 21st Army Group would be cut off in a new Dunkirk. To Hitler's mind, it was a decisive, audacious attack that the Americans would be unable to react to in time. To the German generals tasked with carrying the offensive out, it was wildly overambitious. What Hitler perhaps failed to grasp was that there was a reason the Americans had so easily removed troops on the Ardennes sector, and that was its geography. Steep valleys, dense woods, and numerous rivers had the potential to slow an advance to a crawl, particularly considering the appalling state of most roads in the region. This would be especially damaging to an army of which a startling rate of advance had been demanded, with German tanks ordered to be crossing the Meuse in just 2 days, even faster than had been achieved in perfect weather conditions during the invasion of France in 1940. Wolfgang Model, the man given operational control of the offensive, was not keen on the plan. Model gave it only a 10% chance of success and tried to suggest alternative, more realistic plans, but was rejected. On at least 6 occasions, Hitler refused any changes to his master plan and insisted the offensive go ahead as he planned, setting December 16th as its start date. As the Germans prepared their attack, the Allies were focused on their own planned offensives into the Saarland and towards the Ruhr dams. Through the autumn of 1944, the Allies took their eye off the ball, thinking too much only in terms of what they would do to the enemy next and not what the enemy could still do to them. It wasn't until December 7th that the Allies had any idea that an attack might be imminent, and it took another week for Omar Bradley at 12th Army Group, 1st Army's parent formation, to be fully briefed. Bradley was dismissive of the chances of a German attack succeeding, and is said to have declared, "Let them come." At dawn, on December 16th, Hitler's grand counter-offensive began. 18 divisions in the German front line began their attack, with their immediate objective to seize key road junctions and bridgeheads to allow the 5 Panzer divisions to race towards the Meuse. Opposing the Germans were just 6 American divisions and Combat Command B of the 9th Armoured, holding a 60-mile front line. As grenadiers swarmed across the front line, American communications were hampered by heavy snowstorms, and it was difficult for the local corps commander, Troy Middleton, to build up a clear picture of what was going on. This had dire consequences for the 106th Division, which was holding the line near St. Vith. The 106th Army just arrived in Europe, and its inexperience in the poor weather showed. Poor coordination between its regiments and its divisional HQ led to the 18th Volksgrenadier Division managing to encircle 2 regiments on the second day of the attack. With little in the way of reserves that could be used to rescue the units, both would go on to surrender 2 days later. However, the Germans did not have everything their own way, owing mainly to the bravery of small groups of stubborn GIs. At the village of Lanzerath, a single platoon of the US 99th Division held off repeated attacks from a battalion of German infantry, effectively holding up the spearhead of the 1st SS Panzer Division for an entire day. By the time this spearhead managed to reach Lanzerath, they were already badly behind schedule. The unit's 29-year-old commander, Joachim Piper, commanding Kampfgruppe Piper, demanded they continue to advance through the night to make up the lost time. His determination to allow nothing to delay his formation any further was to have horrific consequences the following day, when men under his command murdered 84 American prisoners of war near Malmedy. The massacre was symptomatic of the callous disregard for human life that the SS bred in its ranks, and word of it quickly spread throughout the Ardennes, stiffening the resolve of American divisions to stand and fight. As Piper and his merry band of war criminals hurried forwards, the Germans were just managing to bring the bulk of their tanks into action, following difficulties bridging the River Ruhr. Lagging behind schedule, it was now vitally important that they take control of the Ardennes' few decent roads, and so the town of Bastogne, at the centre of a number of important routes, became a key objective. Both of 5th Army's closest panzer divisions, 2nd Panzer and the Panzerlehr Division, pushed towards it, shattering the US 28th Division that stood in their way. With the 106th also crippled and its remnants forced back to St. Vith, the centre of the Allied line had now collapsed, threatening the entire Ardennes front. Understanding how severe the situation was becoming, General Eisenhower in Paris mobilised every division available to him. The 101st Airborne, which was refitting at Reims over 100 miles away from the Ardennes, was ordered to immediately deploy to Bastogne. To support them, Eisenhower ordered the 10th Armoured also move immediately for the Ardennes, with part of the division, Combat Command A, to be deployed in support of the 101st. Having been notified late on December 17th, by the morning of the 18th, the first units of 10th Armoured began to arrive in Bastogne, and they were joined less than 24 hours later by 101st Airborne. Across the Ardennes, over 60,000 men were moved into the combat area in just one day, in a stunning logistical achievement. German intelligence had picked up the order to move the 101st on December 17th, but Fritz Beierlein, the commander of the Panzerlehr Division, couldn't see how the Americans could possibly beat him to Bastogne. By the end of the 18th, he was only a handful of miles away. Underlining his confidence in the early hours of the 19th, Beierlein opted to delay his assault on the town in order to clear out US troops on his flanks at Longville. The defenders of the village, a detachment of 10th Armoured, fought fiercely, and by the time Panzerlehr and their supporting Volksgrenadiers had overcome them, it was too late. The 101st arrived in force and established a perimeter, and Panzerlehr's attempts to push into Bastogne that day were a failure. Meanwhile, to the north, the Germans were also halted at Neuville, as two American battalions managed to hold off the entire 2nd Panzer Division for 48 hours. With thousands of battle-hardened American troops now occupying Bastogne, the prospects for taking the town quickly were remote. Furious with the lack of progress, Hitler now tore up his own plan. He ordered 5th Army's panzers to abandon their attempts to take Bastogne and just dash to the Meuse as quickly as possible. Behind them, the 26th Volksgrenadier and 5th Parachute Divisions would encircle the town under the command of Heinrich Luttwitz. Eager to do anything that might accelerate the advance, Luttwitz tried to bluff the Americans into surrendering the town. A lesson that exaggerated the strength of German troops outside Bastogne and threatened destruction and annihilation if they did not comply, he demanded that the 101st commander, Anthony McAuliffe, surrender the town. McAuliffe's response was to generate international headlines. Writing back to the German commander, he replied simply, "Nuts." It was a deeply embarrassing rejection for Luttwitz and yet another setback. Elsewhere in the Ardennes, things were no better for the Germans. As the Allies poured in reinforcements, progress slowed across the entire front. The town of St. Vith was bolstered by 7th Armoured Division and held out until December 21st, denying the Germans another town crucial to control the road network for days on end. Even less progress was made in the north, where the terrain was dramatically worse and Hitler had foolishly ordered the main effort of the advance to take place. After several days of heavy fighting in the vicinity of the Elsenborn Ridge, 12th SS Panzer Division was forced to retreat and move further south. Kampfgruppe Piper, meanwhile, stalled west of Leglise, as the division was blocked by the 82nd Airborne Division arriving from the west. Within a few days, Piper's force would be forced into retreat from his overextended position in the first successful Allied counterattack as evolved. And so it was that 5th Army's central sector saw the greatest success. Joining 2nd Panzer and the Panzerlehr Division was the 116th Panzer Division, which on December 21st had reached the River Ruhr at Hotton, where a small detachment of American troops were landing to hold off their initial attacks. The delay proved to be fateful, as it gave time for the US 3rd Armoured and 84th Divisions to arrive on the opposite bank and block the path west. The two Panzer Divisions emerging from Bastogne had better luck. By December 23rd, Panzerlehr was preparing to assault Rochefort, and 2nd Panzer had its advance units near Celles, just 5 miles from the Meuse crossing at Dinant. It looked likely now that the Meuse could be reached and crossed. Although both divisions were exposed without infantry support and were having to deploy much of their strength to protect their flanks, which blunted their spearhead. That day, as both divisions prepared to resume their advance, the weather turned. The low cloud and fog which had shrouded the German offensive lifted and gave way to a bright, clear day. Perfect flying weather. Hundreds of Allied bombers took over the sky and pummeled German logistics. Supplies to the tanks and desperately needed fuel collapsed. The 116th Division was rendered essentially paralysed around Hotton and was forced to go into the defensive, while 2nd Panzer remained static at Celle. After a day of struggle, Panzer Lehr did manage to secure Rochefort on the morning of Christmas Eve, but it was all too little too late. With each passing day, Allied strength grew and the German chances of success receded. By Christmas Day, it was clear. 5th Panzer Army's race to the Meuse had failed. Hasso von Manteuffel, the commander of 5th Panzer Army, was given the unfortunate task of relaying this information to Hitler's HQ. Confronted with defeat, Hitler ordered an assault on Bastogne, which had become a symbol of stubborn American resistance. Urged on by their Führer, small units tried valiantly to attack the town, but seriously damaged German logistics ended any hope of a full-scale assault occurring before the town could be relieved. The fiercest fighting of the siege came on Christmas Day, when tanks of the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division were able to penetrate the American lines near Champs before being repelled after reinforcements arrived from elsewhere inside the pocket. On December 24th, George Patton's US 3rd Army began a counterattack from the south, aiming to relieve Bastogne. Pushing 7th Army's divisions out of the way, Patton's 4th Armoured Division arrived 2 days later, lifting the siege by breaking through German lines at Assenois and meeting up with troops of the 101st Airborne. Though the Germans would continue to attack vainly around Bastogne for several days more, they would have no success doing so. Over the coming weeks, the Allies would launch a series of counterattacks designed to flatten and push back the bulge and make steady progress doing so. Plunging winter temperatures and vicious German resistance made proclaiming the Ardennes an excruciating task, but it was a matter of time until even Hitler was forced to accept defeat. On January the 9th, he ordered the withdrawal of the 1st and 2nd SS Panzer Corps in an effective admission of defeat. 2 weeks later, the last German units were withdrawn across the frontier they had crossed on December 16th, ending the bulge and the battle that took its name. The Battle of the Bulge was a brutal experience for both sides. The Allies suffered in the region of 96,000 casualties and the Germans between 67,000 and 84,000 troops. While the Allies could absorb and replace both manpower and equipment losses, the Wehrmacht had no such ability. Over 600 irreplaceable German tanks were lost in the offensive and its elite SS formations suffered grievous casualties. With Germany's panzer forces now crippled, there was little that could be done to stem the Soviet tide when it resumed its advance in January. When the Western Allies attacked in the spring, the Western Front also collapsed. Less than 5 months after the Bulge was defeated, the German Reich surrendered.
Weather prayer, sir?
Yes, let's see if we can't get God working with us in this time.
It'll take a pretty thick rug for that kind of praying.
I don't care if it takes a flying carpet.
Well, I don't know how this is going to be received, General. Praying for good weather so we can kill our fellow man.
Well, I can assure you, sir, because of my intimate relations with the Almighty, if you write a good prayer, we'll have good weather. I expect that prayer within an hour.
Yes, sir.
Almighty and most merciful Father, we humbly beseech thee of thy great goodness to restrain this immoderate weather with which we've had to contend. Grant us fair weather for battle. Graciously hearken to us as soldiers who call upon thee, that armed with thy power, we may advance from victory to victory and crush the oppression and wickedness of our enemies and establish thy justice among men and nations. Amen.
So if everybody, before we get started with our program, I'd like to stand up very quietly and stretch your legs before we get started.
What good? I didn't come here to... Let's
settle in first and then we'll introduce them. So if everybody can take your seats again, we're going to get rolling. And when he is finished speaking, we'll have a question and answer period from everybody to fill in things. So without further ado, it's our privilege to welcome frontline combat veteran of the 82nd Airborne Division, the prestigious 82nd Airborne Division, Norbert Stadell, is going to take us back to 1944 and share with us what you endured and how you fought. So thank you for being with us. Let's welcome him.
Same applause I got when they fired me at my last job. My family was introduced, but I would also like to introduce what I consider part of my family. Steve and Shannon, raise your hand. We shared a driveway, and they shared their children, Audrey and Eli, with us. Anyway, they're part of the group. I really didn't come here to talk, I came here to eat. And the food was good. Just to start the business, I want to introduce to you a couple of my props. This guy is from the 82nd Airborne. Oh, sorry. This guy is part of the 82nd Airborne. And after we arrived, he had something to say to some tankers that were kind of retreating. And what does it say there, the big words? I'm the 82nd Airborne, and this is as far as the bastards are going. And he was right. And my favorite prop, it's what is called a gammon grenade. I made this, I'll tell you a little bit about it, and probably a little bit more later, because I did actually throw one in combat. The English introduced this gammon grenade to us during the invasion of Holland in September 17th, same year, 1944. And what happens, you take the cap off, like so, and then it has a pin, you take that up and you heave it like a football, and it goes off on impact. You don't want to catch these guys. Anyway, I actually did use one. Tell you about later, don't forget. So, just a few memory clips that I do remember. My memory's failing me. In fact, a couple of days ago, I read in the paper where there are certain indicators of people beginning to lose their memory.
they listed five, and I remember the all three of them, and they are number one. Okay, back to the war.
He was a teacher.
Yeah, he was president of the school board, too.
Look at once in a while. After the invasion of Holland, in the paper this morning, they had invasion of, or the Holland invasion. Market Garden was in Belgium. That's not true. It was invading Holland. Anyway, we made a combat jump there, and after 2 months, we were pulled out of Holland and sent to a camp in France for reconstruction of the unit. I was at the 508 Parachute Infantry Regiment and prepare for the next jump. And we had hoped that we were preparing for the big spring offensive, and we were thinking maybe we might land right on Tempelhof or Aerodrome in Berlin. Well, we were wrong. December 17th, we were alerted about 4 o'clock in the morning, the whole regiment, to be prepared to go into Belgium and try to combat the German invasion there. Got up around 4 o'clock. I'll not forget the night. We were early in the evening. I had to shove off early in the morning. We only had 10 rounds of ammunition. We didn't have winter clothing except for the long OD jackets, all woolen, that came down to our knees. We did have winter underwear. We wore combat boots, no overshoes. So we were ill-prepared for any type of fighting at that time. But then in the early morning, there were about maybe a mile of semi-trucks lined up to haul us to Belgium. And we ended up jumping in the trucks. It was kind of rainy, a little bit of snow. And I recall that we went through Bastogne into the heartland of Belgium to a place called Werbemonten. And we got out of the trucks. That was a second combat jump off the back of a truck. And for the first, oh, maybe 8-9 days, we didn't see any action at all. We eventually got set up along a ridge in Belgium. It was called Tir du Mont Ridge, a perfect defensive position. We could look down and see a little Christmas-type village, and we had the view that anybody could say was probably the best defensive place in the whole boat. Anyway, Christmas Eve, the 24th, General Montgomery was in charge of the northern flank of the boat, trying to get that straightened out. And he had us pull out of this perfect position and the march at night, Christmas Eve, a place maybe 7 or 8 miles away. So we set up the positions there, dug foxholes and all that, and there was German activity. We knew it because we could hear tanks and stuff, and we dug in. At that time we could still dig a hole because it wasn't, the ground wasn't frozen much. And all of a sudden this motorcycle comes in by, a sidecar, and I just happened to have that damn gammon grenade handy. And I tossed it, I missed it by 10 feet, but it blew the guy off the thing, and I got credit for knocking out, or at least doing something with the motorcycle. That was about the only thing I did that was real positive. Other than that, it didn't do much more. Anyway, we were in that position for a while, and then we had to go back to the Tiergemont Ridge. We had to fight like hell to get it. So we were back at the Tiergemont Ridge, and it was quite different. There were some half tracks knocked out, we could see, and a lot of bombing that the Allies did. And in one case, all of a sudden, a jet flew by, a German jet, first jet that I ever saw. That's one of, everybody, what the hell is that? Anyway, it disappeared, and that was the end of that. Within a few days, we were relieved off the bridge, and we went to a village where we were in reserve for a whole week. We had portable showers. We lived in a barn. At least my company lived in a barn, and had the comfort of that. And we got equipment. Instead of our army blanket, they gave us mummy bags, which kind of like a mummy. You crawl into it and sleep. That helped us a lot. And they also gave us overshoes to keep our toes warm. Four buckle cloth and rubber bottom overshoes. Probably they don't even make them anymore, but they did the job to help us keep our feet warm. After that, we were on the roll toward Germany. We were following the 504 Regiment. They were in the lead position for, oh God, it must have been 2 or 3 days, and it started snowing to beat hell, and the weather was just as much an enemy as the real enemy. So there were some things that happened there that kind of astounded me. For one, we were in the woods, probably leading close to Germany, or maybe we were in Germany, I don't remember. But there were bunkers made out of logs that were set into the ground. They must have been put there for defensive purposes long before the bullets even started. So we go to the bunkers and come and they hear them at the handy hole, we will not shoot you and all that business. And usually they were empty. But we heard, I wasn't close to this, but one bunker had soldiers in it. And anyway, very sadly, one of our junior officers shot six of them as they came out of the bunker. Copying the enemy at his very worst. Most of us were quite sad about that. But then war is hell. Other things that were going on, we were walking along the railroad tracks toward Germany, or maybe we were in Germany, I don't remember, or I didn't know. And there were, as we were walking along the tracks, our runner came back and said, hey, there are Krauts out there coming toward us. Are they armed? He didn't know, so we set up an ambush, and as they approached us, somebody opened fire on us, and I had my M1 zeroed in on a soldier. He was kneeling down, and he put his forearm in front of his face, as if that would do him any good. And I couldn't shoot the poor bastard. I just didn't do it, and I don't know why. I don't know if it was a coward or a hero or what. But to this day, I still wonder, what happened to that guy? What would he have done? If I was in his position, he was in my game. So, things like that occur. and memories don't fade away much. Anyway, when we were at, in France setting up after Holland, we got a lot of replacements, and from experience, the army, or at least our regiment, learned that green soldiers sometimes make stupid mistakes. So I was paired up with two guys named Zemrod and Gudgeon. Anyway, we were walking through the woods, and just the three of us, our platoon was pretty well split up, and there was some patrol action, but not very much. Anyway, we stopped and we were waiting for the others to catch up with us in the line or in the woods. And all of a sudden, Semrat said, "Krauts, dein, dein." Krauts did not turn out to be Krauts. Our company commander and runner were shot dead. Frenzy fire, they call it. That was very sad. And for years, nobody knew what happened. They thought that they were killed by enemy fire that they heard. Fire. Anyway, those are sad things that happened in the war. War is neither romantic, it's not really right. There's nothing to really write home about. War is crazy. Indication that our civilization is still, with all the technology and everything else that goes with it, we're still crawling out of the cave. As the war progressed, my regiment was into the Siegfried Line, and we saw the concrete posts and all that. In other words, sent all over the place. I don't remember the names of the cities or anything. My friend Jerry Smith, who's here tonight, would know every town and every move that I made. He must have studied them. So, Jerry, wave at them. I'm 94 and he's a bit older than I am. In knowledge and spirit. What else do I have here to tell you? After we were pulled out of the boats, we went back to Camp Sassoon. Then it became a hospital. So Camp Sassoon was now tent city for us. So we ended up looking forward to our next mission like hell we did. We lost a lot of good guys. One of my friends, last name Thacker, Billy Thacker, he and I and another guy were on patrol duty. It was called a making patrol. We were marching through the snow, heavy snow and all that. And we had to make contact with the group next to us, the next platoon. And we were walking along the tree line, and all of a sudden, a burp got burp. That was the end of it. The shooter just vanished. Back I got it in the stomach. His last words were, "Mama, help me." But sad. Anyway, many years later, I was in New Jersey. He was from Orange, New Jersey. And I was going to speak to his parents or some of his relatives. Anyway, I looked in the phone book. There must have been 80 Vacas in that area, so I just decided to forget. So I lost my buddy there. Such is a way of war. our last mission, it really wasn't a mission, but we were sent to Chartres, France, cathedral town, for the last jump that we would make. This was in April, and we're at this airport ready to make the jump to relieve prisoners of war. And some thought that we might be making that final jump in Berlin, but that didn't materialize. The war was over on the 8th of May, and everybody was kind of happy about that. So my regiment was then relieved from the 508, and we were sent to Frankfurt, Germany for occupational duty. Patton, Eisenhower, all the big wigs, including President Truman, came there. We were called the so-called Honor Guard. And it worked out quite well for us because we were living in German apartments. And at I.B. Farben Industries, which made poisonous gas, was the headquarters of the Allied Command. And part of our mission was to guard the doors. And oftentimes we'd see generals that we saw pictures of and so on, including Eisenhower. And during the football season, our regiment played another regiment, and Eisenhower and Patton were sitting on the sidelines of one side, and during the halftime, they decided to have a race to the other side. So they started running, and Patton was way ahead of Eisenhower, and all of a sudden he pretended that he stumbled, and Eisenhower passed him, and Patton did this. Who the hell has a rank here? And what am I going to do? I had enough points to go home. It was, let's see, September, so on the way home, we had to join other units, and I was with the 101st to go home as a division and make the victory parade in New York. Well, politics started occurring there as it is today, and they decided the 82nd, because it had more combat experience, to make the victory parade rather than the 101st. So off comes the 101st patch, on with the, a little bit confusing. So on January 1946, the 12th of the month, we made the victory parade in New York. And for me, that was the last important engagement that I was involved in. And that's it. Any questions?
Wait, we'll tag it from here.
I can tell you the very truth. I was always the very first guy, when things got rough on the firing line, to volunteer and run my ass back to battalion for help.
Well, we're going to have some questions from people, but I've known you for some time. We have a Christmas gift for you. This is a premier pair of merino wool socks. Share with us. Winter, listen folks, share with us, winter warfare, what's it like sleeping out in the snow or in some cold village, and how did you keep your feet warm, and what did you see for soldiers who suffered from frostbite?
That's a good point. I always carried an extra pair of socks next to my skin, and every day, I would try to find time to change my socks. I did not get trench foot as many people did. So any warfare that I might be in the next few weeks.
So when you were fighting there on the Ardennes, what percentage of the time did you sneak in some village basement or floor, or what percentage of the time were you out in the woods in a foxhole or in a sleeping bag?
We rarely had the chance to sleep in buildings or anything like that. In one case, we were in a barn, and at first it looked like nobody was in it, but then we heard a man moaning and groaning, and we didn't have a flashlight or anything, so kind of made our way toward the guy, and there was a German lady attending to the German soldier that was wounded, and we offered what we could. Anyway, couldn't do any good. He died. Memory quit.
So explain to us food. Did you ever have any hot food wagons come for you, or was everything cold sea rations?
When we were in reserve, we had good food. Usually we had K rations, a box with cheese and meat, stuff like that. And we had sea rations, which were a little bit better. And then finally, they had a big box for one squad. They were called 10-in-1 rations. The usual cigarettes, chocolate. D-bar was a big, hard chunk of chocolate. We made cocoa out of that. And we would take the composition C2 out of our gammon grenades, put it on fire and heat up the D-bar chocolate. It was pretty good.
So, you're in marching, you're marching all day, and maybe you're getting transported by a vehicle. How many hours were you able to sleep, and what's it like having to sleep in the woods when it's, you know, way below zero? Explain that to us, those conditions.
We tried to dig holes in the ground, foxholes, and as the weather got worse and cold, we couldn't break through the top soil. We did whatever we could, covered up with pine boughs. And we had raincoats, so we threw that over our sleeping bag. It worked out okay. There were some guys that with trench foot, and one person shot his own leg, the muscular part, just to get the heck out of it.
Was there a time when you men thought, hey, this looks really bad, we might not win this, they might win? Was there ever a level of fear where people were in a desperate situation, or any thoughts on that? Were you ever just in a real close time when you thought you never were going to make it?
There was plenty of fear, but we always figured we were going to make it, win the war. So
Paul, do you have a question? Okay, question and answer period. Instead of us taking the microphone out here, it's a great distance. What we'd like you to do is just shout real loud where I can hear, and then I'll relay it to our speaker. So if you've got a question, stand up and call out loudly.
Did you ever have the honor of meeting General Gavin?
Yes. He was my general. We filmed quite a bit when we were in garrison. Combat, I never saw him once. He was a good guy.
He was a great general.
In fact, when he wrote his book, On to Berlin, I bought a copy, put it in a box, then I put my name and address on it, and I put that box in another box, and I'll be damned, he signed it for me.
When you were marching in the Victory Parade in New York, was he there? Did you see him amongst them?
Oh, yes.
Tell us about that.
The Victory Parade was real interesting. We were, the 82nd Division made the Victory Parade, but there were many units that were called from stateside to join just to fill in the gap because we didn't have any soldiers that were in combat units. So it was a combination of anybody that was available. Plus they brought in some tanks and half tracks just to make it interesting.
Another question out there. Someone, yes, yeah, stand up, Alan.
Tell us a little bit about your jump into Market Garden. What base did you fly out of? I'm assuming you dropped out of the C-47. Tell us a little bit about what that was like.
The jump into Holland was the first day was very uneventful. The jump was a success. We organized very quickly, and we were a mile from the German border, by the way, and there was a German soldier sitting on the porch of a house watching us. We just ignored him. It took maybe 2 days before we really got organized. The same day, our regiment tried to take the bridge that we were supposed to take, and that was blocked. And then the English didn't take the bridge, so it was called the movie about Bridge Too Far. The whole mission wasn't accomplished, but we were there for 2 months, mostly in defensive position.
Where did you fly out of Dorf?
Airport near Nottingham, England. Nice sunny day.
More hands. We have way in the back, real loud.
Market Garden, how was the communications and how did it screw up the entire operation?
As I understand it, the U.S. intelligence didn't believe what some of the locals in Holland were telling them, that as the Germans backed up, they had many units, especially around Arnhem. So the English got killed there. I don't know if that answered your question.
Can I make it?
Okay, next one. Have you ever kept in touch after the war with any of the men in your company? You ever had reunions and so forth? Was there any in the...
By accident, I learned that the 508 had an organization. And I learned that by seeing a license plate, I was in the scene. They had a dedication of a bridge there for the airborne, and I had 508, so I looked him up. He said, "Norb, you got to join our unit." "What unit?" 508 Parachute Infantry Regiment Association. So I did that. Once a year, we had reunions in different parts of the United States, and the reunions wore on, the stories got better.
So, Norbert, coming back home, how was adjustment in the late 1940s? Did you adjust well, or was it difficult for you emotionally or psychologically, or did you take it right in stride? Explain 1947, 48, 49, those years.
Well, first of all, 19-year-old people are kind of dumb. They accept it. And I don't think, I think of the war almost every day, but no big deal. War is stupid.
Yeah.
We'll get to more questions in a bit. Paul Ranke, you have some show and tell things here that might bring this a little alive to people. What do you have? You've got some interesting memorabilia there.
Well, not much. A lot of you might have recognized some of this, some of you veterans especially. This was the German Mauser, which was designed in 1898. It was a bolt-action rifle, so every time you shot it, you had to use a bolt, and it was a 5-round shot. The M1 Grand that the Americans used was a semi-automatic with an 8-round clip. So Patton, I think, labeled that as the best battle implement device ever devised. Technology in the war was obviously quite astronomically expanding. In the beginning of the war, most tanks were shooting something about this size, the 40-millimeter round, 37 to 45-millimeter round is what the tanks were shooting at that time in all countries. By the time the war ended, the Germans were shooting stuff bigger than this. This was their 88. I'm sure a lot of you who were studying World War II, you've heard about the German Tiger tanks or 88s. This is what they were shooting. And they even got to 128-millimeter, bigger than that. So technology in the war was astronomical. As was mentioned, in the beginning of the war, they were flying. A lot of countries had fixed wheel aircraft, some of them had biplanes. by the end of the war, they were flying jets 4 or 5 years later. So, Norm, I have a question for you. Have you ever gone back over to Europe? And if you haven't, did you ever have any inclination or interest in going? Have you ever been back to Europe, and have you ever wanted to go?
Sure, I was back at the 50th anniversary, and the people, especially in France, really laid out the carpet for us. And we saw most of the places where we flocked.
You have another question from the back.
I'd like your opinion on what I'm about to say. When I deer hunt, I use the M1 Garand. So when John Garand was designing his semi-automatic rifle, the first three prototypes featured detachable box magazines. In other words, you would load the M1 Garand from underneath, just like you would the carbine. Because I'm sure one of the problems I have when I'm deer hunting is cold. It's hard to get that clip to seat down and then get the bolt forward. In fact, I ran into a mountaineer from the 10th Mountaineer in Colorado, and he said we used to pee on our M1 Garand. So my bottom line is, his original was pushed down by the military because another guy convinced them you load from the top. What's your feeling if you could have loaded that just like a carbine and it had a 40-round clip? It'd be like a machine gun, would it not?
The carbine?
No. The original M1 Garand.
We did not have any clips I think it was a 10-foot.
No, what I'm trying to say, his original design would be feeding from the bottom, just like a carbine. And the military said, no, we want it fed from the top. Yeah. When it's cold, it's hard to get that thing in there.
Well, we didn't have much of it. We kept real good care of our weapons. Machine guns follows up once in a while. Carbines, not many people carry carbines. So the M1 was a good weapon.
Anybody else out there? Real, stand up and real loud.
How long would it take to dig a foxhole?
It depends on the ground. If you have soft ground, it wouldn't take more than that. By the way, I'm glad you asked that question. A shovel was the second most important weapon we carried. Anyway, it was the shovel that we had, where the blade would fold into the handle, and we'd wear it on our hip. It would take good digging, maybe half hour, to do it real well. If we were in a hurry, if we were under attack or something like that, 10 minutes, 5 minutes. And when we were on the Turgid Minch, when we were on this cliff place, it was all stone, we couldn't dig in at all, but we piled up stone. A formation, and our newcomers didn't want to do that. So I made my formation out of stone over there, and we had some mortar attack. I jumped in my formation, and these two other guys that didn't jump, they jumped on top of me.
Norbert, in past times, you told us you, from a northern climate, knew how to take to your feet. So going back to it again, 10,000 soldiers were taken out in the Battle of Bulge because of the frostbitten feet, and they had just leather boots. And General Napoleon, he said, an army marches on its feet, and a soldier is only as good as his feet. I think you mentioned sometime you saw what men who neglected their feet, what happened when they took their boots off.
They tore their socks off and part of their toes had come with it.
Did you have shoe packs that were rubber, or were they all leather, your boots?
The parachute jump boots are made out of leather, and they gave us not felt boots, but overshoes to put over them. Anyway, the 1st Mountain Division in Italy became our replacements toward the end of our presence in the gulch, and they had parkas, they had pack boots, they had the best of everything, and they replaced many of our guys. I was the acting squad leader at the time, and a guy came in, and he had rank, so I went back to PFC. But they were good guys.
Norbert, our time's running away from us. I'm going to make a few comments about next month, but we always ask our veterans to leave us with closing comments, and in a moment I'm going to ask you to do that. So collect your thoughts. We've got close to 200 people here, and what's the final words you want to leave with them? So in a minute we'll ask you to address that. But everybody, once again, in January 20th, if you're new here, come back. We'll sign you up and put you on email, or you can check the newspapers. It'll be about the Malmedy massacre. There's a Wisconsin connection to it. We'll have maybe some other veterans who were not necessarily at that massacre site, but we got some interesting footage of the survivor of that who I met personally and did an interview with him in the year 2003, 2 months before he died. Tremendous footage. So we're going to continue on the Battle of the Bulge in January, and we want to appreciate you all being here. We have a whole series of good speakers coming up in the year 2020. So everybody, safe Christmas time. Be careful on the roads. And we love you all. Thanks for your support. Norbert, closing comments here with all these people after 75 years. What would you like to leave with us here now as we wrap up?
I just want to say a couple of things. The Germans did have one psychological combat weapon, and that was the screaming Mimi artillery. Have you ever heard of that?
Yep.
Okay. Anyway, it was a rocket type thing. They had several barrels within a unit, and they'd shoot these damn things up in the air, and they'd scream like crazy to scare the hell out of anybody, including me. Very inaccurate, but when you hear them come, you want to jump in the hole. And also, I want to say this. The Victory Parade. I watched it on TV several times whenever they showed it, and then there was a 10-minute tape on it, so I was watching it. And as I detected, I was the only one in the whole damn division that was out of step. Anyway, my last remark will be a joke. The guy was making a speech about his to some middle school students about his war experience in the Philippine Islands. He was talking about the culture, the music, the climate, and all that. He didn't say anything about the war. So the kid in the back raised his hand and said, "Did you kill anybody?" He thought about it a lot. Probably did. I was a cook.
Thank you.